Thank you for staying with us on TVC Breakfast. Well, the once peaceful and serene environment of Nigeria's capital, Abuja, has now been infiltrated by criminals. Kidnappers and bandits are on the prowl, leaving residents of the Federal Capital Territory in fear for their lives. Nigerians have been troubled by insecurity in the country, but the recent cases of kidnap and murder over failure to pay ransoms to kidnappers compounds the problem. This January, 10 people were abducted from their homes in the Federal Capital Territory, and so far the abductors have killed 3 of them for failing to pay the ransom demand placed on them, sending a strong signal to their relatives. Well, the kidnappers have now jacked up the initial ransom demand from 60 million per person to 100 million, and this now totals about 700 million being demanded for the rescue of before the victims can be released. Joining us via Zoom now is UK-based security expert Femi Aratukwale. Thank you very much for joining us at this time. Good to see your face again this new year. But it's yet another unpalatable news that we will be discussing. Well, so far, as a way to stem the worrying tide in Abuja, the IGP has, of course, spoken out, talking about a comprehensive plan of action to rescue the victims unhurt. What are your thoughts on this? Hello, Femi. Hello, Femi Aratukwale, can you hear me? All right, we'll try to reconnect with Femi Aratukwale, who is joining us from the UK. But so much to ponder on. It's such a worrying development, Ibrahim. I was about to, raise earlier on during the paper review. All right, Femi is back. We will, explore all these, developments regarding this worrying trend of insecurity in Abuja during the course of the allotted time with you. But Femi, what are your thoughts about this spate of insecurity in the FCT?
And good morning once again. Good morning, Nigeria. We're not going to say this is the start of a good year for the security architecture in Nigeria. And I can...
Right, we're having yet another challenge connecting with our guest, Ibrahim. While we try to reconnect, what dimensions are you looking at?
Well, it's a welcome development that the government, is now speaking or has been speaking. Nyesom Wike, who is the minister of the FCT, before it was just like, does he realize that he's the minister of the FCT, is more interested in politics happening in River State, because most of these utterances reflect this. But then it's good that he, meeting with the president, also meeting with some of the local council chairmen, and also meeting with the security agents, they are talking about this. Mr. Ali, we understand that you are already back. Could you carry on with the first question, posed to you?
Basically, just like I said before, it's good that the government is talking. It's good that Wilson Wike is equally talking to assure Nigerians a lot can actually be done. You and I both know it. You can track from my record that I have been talking about this issue for a long time, that until it hits where it's not meant to hit, then we'll realize that we're not making any gains. But however, and I'll say it, however, do you really think the 700 million these criminals are asking for can, equate the lives we've lost in the past? Or have we learned any lessons from what has been happening in the past? Or do you think this will be the stop of it? No, it's not. Because things we're meant to do in the past, we've completely failed to do it. I'm not really blaming or sticking it to this present administration. I will not. Because past administration seems to have failed, and now they've carried the whole bonding onto this new administration. So that simply means they want this administration to now carry the dirty work and see how they can do it. But the question is this. Can they do it, or they're going to play politics with it? Will they actually give results to who results should be given to in terms of paying the reward of those that have been how do I put it this way, arrested and give them their real result, which is either way penalty they're going to give them, let them have it. Because in the past, those that have been apprehended, what exactly has been done? Nothing. So they've seen it as a way of making business happen. It's a cash cow business for them, and they are making gains from it, whereby the criminals are gaining and the government seems to be losing. And who are those well affected now? The member of the public. The member of the public believe and rely solely on the government to provide this security they've asked for them. This is part of their mandate, and seems nothing has been done so far. So we don't need to wait till situation goes this way before we start acting. There should be a proactive measure. So many loopholes are there, but we're not actually blocking them. So now we can be talking tough on it. But if we talk tough on it, does that simply mean we have a KPI to check what has been done in the past and what will be done in the near future right now?
That's right. But then some are of the opinion that, because you'll be wondering why we're having increasing, you know, in the spate of crimes, criminality, kidnapping, etc. Some are of the opinion that this is a correlation between hunger, the rising hunger in the land. That is why some people are foraying into this kind of adventure. But then, do you see any correlation? Even though crimes and criminality has been there from time immemorial, talk about Adam and Eve, you know, there are the crimes, you know, ever reported.
Well, if we talk about the present situation, the present economy, and what we have in the country today, we can't really, I don't want to put it together that this is why people have got to go into kidnapping or seize as a way of, or as a means of, you know, making ends meet. No, it's not really right. We shouldn't encourage that, and it should not even at all come into the platform at all to be talking about that, oh, because we don't have anything to do again in the country, that is why we now resorted back into kidnapping or paying ransom or whatsoever. Don't we have laws? We have laws that actually say a lot or says a lot about, if you do this, if you commit this, this is going to be the price to pay for it. But the question again is this: have we seen anybody paying the price? Let us remember Clifford Oji in Lagos State. Let me remind you of Evans as well. What exactly has been done so far? And many more that have actually been arrested. What are we seeing being done? We have the victims crying for justice, and we have the real perpetrators not even doing anything. The police, the military, the government, they seem to have turned a blind eye. Well, I think when the whole thing is now hitting Abuja now, we can see the result. And the result is this: investors will run away. When investors run away, it will now bring us back to, who are the people that will definitely do the job for us? No one is going to be. A lot of security experts are in Nigeria over there. They've not been contacted. They've not been given the platform that, come around, let us see what you can do. It is not just only by the firepower of AK-47 or your revolver or your pistols. There are so many ideas out here that can actually be done that will reduce this rate at which people are kidnapping to zero. But we seem not to care about it. Let me give you a typical example. I'm on national TV today. I can reduce this within 30 days. I can reduce this within 60 days. But the question is this: where are the platforms? I have advocated for this for a long time. A lot of security experts have advocated for so much implementation to happen, but it's never happened at all. Our security officers are doing their best that they can do. But the question is, are they being given the right tools? Have they been given the right budget? Are they being supported and backed that, you know what, go after these criminals and we're 100% behind you? The answer to that again is no. So politics seems to have taken over a lot of domestic things that our security officers are meant to have.
And coupled with this is the fact that, okay, in Nigeria, payment of ransoms have since been deemed illegal, but we are having, you know, this poor victims and their family members, you know, having to resort to. They say this is the only means that they can. So they are detaching themselves away from the security agencies owing to these some of the problems that you have enumerated, and thus, of course, no blame on them, but, you know, somehow this is also fueling the empire that kidnapping has now become. What do you think?
See, Victoria, it is not about what do I think. What we should be talking about is, do we have a measure that can actually put this whole thing in place and actually see it as history? The answer to that is yes. But the question again is, will you see the government of today or the past government, do you think they can do anything to make it happen? It's another question we should be asking. Yes, if they are serious about it, if they are talking tough, then we should see the action in place. Not just action in place, but putting some policies in place that will definitely work, and it will definitely work effectively. We have the NIN, we have the BVN, we have the Minister for Communication, we have the network providers, we have the Interior Minister there. We have so many people around that can actually come together, not living behind the CDN, not living behind the National Union of Road Transport Workers, not living behind the whole kind of security vigilantes that we have around. We have all these tools to us, but are we using them? The question to that is no. Are we connecting together to see how they can all work effectively and have a common communication and understanding as in, this is what we need to do, this is how we should go, this is the chain in command, this is how communication should go, and this is how we should assure the member of the public that this is the steps we're taking and is working effectively for us. We're not seeing all this, so that simply means the National Orientation Agency needs to come up with a blueprint plan that will work with the presidency, that will work with the governors and all other stakeholders in this game, and make sure we tackle it heads on rather than talking tough and not seeing action with it.
I'm wondering what we've been doing so far, that this thing seems to be very evasive. You're not able to, you know, nip it in the bud, so much so that the thing has now expanded. But a lot of opinionists, I mean, people have already said, let us bring up, or let us establish state policing so that we'll have effective policing of our communities and all of that. But others are saying that this is very much, you know, dangerous for them to do, because other state governors might be using it to their own advantage. But the question is, why does it look like our fear is now bigger than the advantage we are likely to derive from having state policing? Because, you know, look at Forest Guards, which the president is saying that he's going to bring up, as well as looking at privatizing the security agencies, you know, enlisting private organizations to help us, you know, to contribute to the security in the land. How do you see all of this?
You see, thank you for this very question you just raised. And let me just bring it back to everybody's memory. Growing back, way back in Nigeria, Forest Guards seems to have been existing in the past. And what they doing then was just to monitor that, okay, fine, our woods, our forestry are well protected. But at the long run, at the end of the day, we seem to have, you know, just scrapped the idea of Forest Guard and everything before the issue of Amotekun and all the rest now seems to be surfaced or put in place. But yes, we are in 20th century right now. Then the question is this, how do we bring Forest Guard to work alongside with all this local security that we have around and work again with this security architecture in Nigeria, the NSA, the Nigerian police, and the military? If we can see something like this come up, then Forest Guard will be the answer to so many of these questions we're asking and we're raising. That doesn't mean that we cannot have the state policing, but the question is this, how trustworthy are politicians, or should I call them the leaders, to make sure that state policing will not be hijacked for political purposes during the election and after election or during campaign? Those are the things people are worried about. This is not just about having state policing for security of our neighbors, of our environment. But what people are asking is this, if you create the state policing...
But even talking about election, talking about using them for election, that is just, you know, seasonal. As again, in comparison to, you know, using them to secure our lives and property.
Let me tell you one thing. If you think it's seasonal, let me ask you, after election, how many of all these are security groups that I've mentioned so far, have you seen walking alongside the roads, I mean, our environment, our streets, effectively, and bringing reports and results back to the command center or maybe to the police to nip criminals within our environment? The answer to that is zero. A typical example is Lagos State. Look at our neighbor safety, our neighborhood safety calls. What are they doing? Tell me exactly what are they doing. Have you actually seen one of them walking around Lagos streets and bringing information that will help the community or help the police to apprehend criminals? The answer to that again is no. Let us look at Amotekun. You see them around junctions and everywhere, but you see them communicating and engaging with members of the public? The answer to that again is no. Let us look at our police officers. Have you actually seen them, apart from patrolling and arresting, engaging with the community? What we are asking is, can our security personnel engage with our members in town? Can they engage with the Nigerian populace? Can they engage with the citizens? Can they bring back the way things should work is what we're asking for. Not how they should forcefully do things. Let us engage. If we engage, you will see so many ideas coming up. This is why we call it security communication. We do not have that in Nigeria, and they don't have the tools, they don't have the apparatus to use that will bring sanity, that will bring trust in between the two people we have now. Let us leave the politicians aside, but the security and the public needs to understand that it is about them. Once it is about them, then others can follow suit. This is my own understanding, and this is why we've been advocating for different kinds of training programs. We've been bringing it on board. Look, Victoria, you and I both know it. Veronica, I have spent millions coming to Nigeria to do a whole lot. I'm not asking the government for it, but I want a country that will work for my people, my children, and my grandchildren. And legacy can always tell that, yes, during your time, you've tried your best. But the question is, what are the successful governments done to bring this about? The security budget votes, what has it been used for in the past? Have you actually audited? Yeah. The answer to that again is no. It has never been audited. They see it as just straight to their pocket, and that's it. And this is the result of not auditing or asking questions or bringing people back to come and account for things they've done during their government. This is where we have found ourselves now.
Right, and the IGP has, of course, you know, called for coordinated and comprehensive action to correct the situation. And, you know, tell us how hopeful you are. Because we have about at least two families in Abuja with under this current episode of insecurity, of kidnapping specifically. How hopeful are you that these families will get their loved ones back pretty soon?
Well, to be honest with you, I feel for these families, and I can only hope. I don't want to pray. I can only hope that things will come to a situation whereby the rest of the family members are returned back safely to them. But however, when you mention the IGP has said this, is doing that, in what capacity, at what level can you tell me that he's actually doing it? Look exactly and tell me what are the things that has been done that you can say, okay, I can give the IGP pass mark here, I will give him pass mark there. I'm not criticizing him, please. And I will not criticize any security personnel. But all I'm saying is this, are you doing enough? Or you're just saying this just to appease, or, you know, to make people think, oh, you are working. We want to see a whole lot of things done the way it should be done. Not just let us talk about it and do this or that. Again, a lot of Nigerians don't have hope again in our police system, in our security system. Why? Because a lot of things will definitely just be said and nothing will be done. Or perhaps justice will never be served the way it should be served. That is why you see a lot of people, you know, when they ask for ransom, they just say, you know what? Let me just ditch the idea of calling the police. Let me go and do it myself. So that simply means we've wasted billions and billions and billions over time, and we've not achieved a single result. But to me, I believe result can be achieved in a very swift manner if we really want to tackle it heads on. Ideas are there, but the government seems not to turn their eyes towards the ideas. Rather, they just turn their blind eyes. Or perhaps we have some people or some unknown faces cashing out, making gains out of this. So this is why a lot of people don't want to believe in whatever the IG is saying. I'm not saying the IGP is not talking, but the answer to that is this. No real action can be seen so far.
Right. I'm going to be asking you two questions in one. First is the one you talked about, the monies that are being paid, the ransom that are being paid for, you know, these kidnappers. They're also watching. They are monitoring trends. They're seeing how people are reacting on TVs, radios, newspapers, etc. These kidnappers in Abuja, for instance, in the FCT, they requested for something like 50 million naira, and then they jacked it up to like 100 million naira, and now we are talking about 700 million naira. You know, they just kept, you know, changing the figures as if the monies can be mined, you know, from the ground. What is the impact of this? You know, when people are kidnapped and then there is crowdfunding because the victims' families are not able to. They just have to get they have to save their families. That's one. Secondly, it is very funny to hear that Abuja is not well policed. What's up with the CCTVs installed across the FCT? Because there was this time during the Buhari administration where they said that they will be installing CCTVs all across. So how about, you know, shouldn't this administration probe into the previous administration's, you know, funding to getting these CCTVs around and putting the country under surveillance?
Come on, please. I'm sorry that on national TV, I can't be laughing like that. What is CCTV? Every year in and out, there are budgets and budgets are going out for security, for different kind of measures to be put in place. Well, tell me, how many have you physically seen? In Lagos State, I will use Lagos State as an example. Nothing can be seen, can you can't tailor it down to this is it, this is what we've done, and this is how far things have been going. In Lagos State, I can remember, was it not 2 years ago or 3 years ago? CCTV body cam was actually commissioned by Governor Sanwo-Olu. He wore it. He gave it to the last man to wear. At some point in time, I actually went undercover to ask the last man, how far are your CCTV working? And the key thing they told me was shocking, that, let me say it in Yoruba language, when they say, that simply means we're just wearing it. However, it's actually not effective, not doing anything. So it is not just about, let us launch, let us bring this fat elephant project out without it working. Abuja, Lagos, every state should have their own CCTV with a good database to record and analyze criminal activities. But things like this are not done. So if we keep talking about, oh, CCTV infrastructure, this one infrastructure, that one infrastructure, the question is this, state governments, federal government, they have budget for all this. They have account for all this. But have we seen it in place? In so many training programs I've actually done in Nigeria, I used to bring it up. This is just a CCTV. It doesn't cost anything. Veronica, you could remember the last time you asked me for this. And I said, oh, I'll bring it out. These are CCTV. They are so cheap. A lot of all this, our security can have it, but we don't find it around. So the question is who is responsible for all this? Is the question people should be asking now. Who is responsible? Okay, fair enough, that administration is gone. What is Wike doing with the CCTV? Where is the project? Who is handling it? How many people are trained to monitor CCTV from the control room? Is what they should be asking and talking about. How would they analyze it? How would they apprehend people? How would they not say to drivers or the national road safety workers, if you're driving or traveling or doing this, we want you guys to have vehicle cam in your vehicle, which is the dash cam. So at least it can analyze and, you know, record a lot of situation on the road. We don't have all this implementation in place. So if we're just talking, let us know that we're not just talking politics, but we're talking real business, and the business has got to be, how do we save people? How do we allow people to trust and put their trust in us and hope in us that, yes, we're not just talking, rather we're actually working. But what I have today is we just want to talk so that people can see us as, the, oh, we're talking tough. But action-wise, we're just low out there. This is one thing I've seen. And I'm not saying that they cannot do it. They can do it. But the question is, why are they not doing it? Or who are the people they've given these projects to that refuse to do it, or perhaps it has been embezzled one way or the other? Something has happened, so who is responsible? Those people should be brought back to book, and they should give account to why they've done what they've done.
All right, Femi, some people have posited that what is also fueling the insecurity that we are seeing in the FCT could also be as a result of the security situation with its neighbors, states bordering the FCT. And then there's also the issue that, okay, security might have somewhat improved in some parts of the north, and then the fleeing bandits are now seeing the FCT as, you know, a form of, you know, shelter where they can carry on their trade. And, you know, all of this, so many speculations as to why it has to be FCT, the seat of power. What are your thoughts?
Well, my thoughts are so simple. Why they're actually targeting the FCT, which is Abuja, is for one single reason. Or should I say my own thoughts or suggestions are two things. Let me say it this way, just to tell the present government that you can't do anything about security. It's our right. We have to cash from it. Or in another way, again, bringing democracy back to its knees, that, you know what, democracy can never work and it's not going to work. But the worst part of it is this, investors out there are looking and watching us, that is this the country I want to come to invest with, that security cannot even tackle certain crime or criminal activities? So the question is, these investors will run away, and it's going to have a negative impact in our country and give our security, the government, a very bad name and bad image when it comes to outside world. Because what we're doing today, what is happening today, is actually being seen socially worldwide through the social media. So a lot of people are asking, what is the situation with Nigeria in terms of kidnapping, ransom, and everything? Right now, people will start making foreign exchange rates and understanding that what is 700 million to pounds to dollars to this to that. So again, it boils down to money, finances. And again, the question is this: how do we trace all these stuff down? It can be traced, a lot can be done, but the question is this: is Wike ready for action? If Wike is ready for action, Veronica, I'll tell you, tell him to call me. The actions, the answers are readily simple. But with TVC, please go down there and ask questions. Look around Lagos State and see, are the CCTV actually working? Even at that, if they are working, who are those responsible behind the scene working to analyze issues?
Femi Aratoko, thank you very much for your contributions on TVC Breakfast this morning. We appreciate it.